Good afternoon, everyone. If we can find our seats. I'm excited to, thanks. Good afternoon, my name is Kelly Huber. I'm the program director for the National Journalism Center. The National Journalism Center, like Young Americans for Freedom, the Reagan Ranch, and our Center for Entrepreneurship and Free Enterprise, is a project of Young America's Foundation. NJC gives students an opportunity to intern in Washington, D.C. and gain practical, hands-on journalism experience in the newsroom. We match 4 days a week in outlets like Fox News, C-SPAN, The Washington Times, The Washington Examiner, WMAL, and USA Today, with a fifth day each week in the classroom, learning the ins and outs of journalism and talking with prominent journalists and public policy officials on the state of media and what you can do to change the tide of our biased media. During both sessions of our program this year, this next speaker was ranked at the top. Notable for his energy, enthusiasm, and impressive career, he was described as funny, engaging, informed, and charismatic. Host of The Larry O'Connor Show, Larry O'Connor joined WMAL in 2012. Previously, Larry guest hosted the nationally syndicated Dennis Miller Show, as well as programs on WMAL, WABC, and local markets in New York, Philadelphia, and Chicago, among others. He began his talk radio career by hosting an online radio show on Blog Talk Radio while he was editor of Breitbart TV. Before working for Breitbart, he worked in management for various Broadway musical theaters. Larry is an associate opinion editor as well as a columnist for the Washington Times and is a frequent guest on Fox News. As a reminder, we thank all of those who are attending in person as well as online this afternoon. And we remind you that you can submit questions for Larry at yaf.org/virtualpass. We're excited to have Larry O'Connor with us this afternoon, so please join me in welcoming him up to the stage.
Thank you so much. That is very nice. Thank you. Hi, good afternoon. I'm last, right? So you're like, make it fast, man. The Michigan Wolverines versus Rutgers, the kickoff is in 30 minutes. If I do this right, they said 40 minutes, then questions and answers. We'll be about end of the first quarter. We'll be up by 4 touchdowns. We'll all meet in the bar, have a beer. Anyone here from Rutgers? Yeah, I wouldn't say so either, yeah. Good afternoon. Thank you for having me here. Thank you to Young America's Foundation. You all look great. You look like you're having a great time as well. You should be having a great time. This is a great time to be in Washington, D.C. Hello to everyone watching and streaming online, my home away from home, including possibly my kids who are watching in Southern California. I love talking to Young America's Foundation because I'm the father of some young Americans. My oldest, Quinn, is a freshman at UCLA. Bruins? She's representing. All right. My second oldest, Veronica, is a senior in high school, and I'm not going to say where she wants to go because I don't want to jinx it, so we'll hold it off. But it's in Annapolis. And then I have a son, Christian, who is almost 14. He's an eighth grader. And EJ, my youngest, is 11 years old. So being a parent, having young people, learning about what this country is all about is very, very important to me. And I'm honored not only to be able to talk to this great group and all of the other groups that I've spoken to for Young America's Foundation, but it's a big part of what I do every day on my program. So I am a talk radio host, but not every talk radio host is nationally syndicated with a powerful microphone and 500 or 600 radio stations. Washington, D.C. is the seventh largest market in the country. It includes Maryland, Northern Virginia, but of course, you know that there's no such thing as a market in radio anymore because you can listen online, you can listen on an app. So I have listeners to my show. Well, let's face it, if you like political commentary, news talk radio, and there's a radio station in Washington, D.C., you're going to check that station out, right? Because our local stories are still national stories. I mean, the White House is, you know, right down the street. That's in our neighborhood. So I've got listeners in California. I've got listeners in Florida. I've got listeners in Michigan. I've got listeners in, well, it's mostly family members. But they are all listening online as well. So I invite you to and ask your parents to as well. They've asked me to do a little bit of political analysis after the midterms, because this is a pretty cool time to be in this town. It's what everybody's talking about. And I do want to talk about that, and I'm going to. I really am. But I'm also going to talk about how you can be a part of the the next round of political stories in this country. I mean, who's here because in their own private, special little way, they want to change the world? Let me hear you, because they can't see you online. Do you want to change the world? I'm going to give you some tips on how you can change the world by the end of this conversation, so stick with me. So this midterm, what was it all about? I like to boil it down to the four P's, all right? And that would be politics, power, the presidency, and the press. Let's start with the press. They're fun, aren't they? Is there anyone here with the National Journalism Center or thinking about joining the National Journalism Center with Young America's Foundation? Excellent. That's actually how I first learned about Young America's Foundation. I didn't actually know what YAF was, but I knew what NJC was. I knew what National Journalism Center was because I was brought into this whole world from Andrew Breitbart. You heard in the great introduction there that I used to work in Broadway. I used to work in musical theater, not as a performer, although I am a triple threat. Why is that funny? But I was in the management side of it, but I was a news and political junkie. I worked on Broadway and I worked in Los Angeles for shows, for live theatrical productions. Anyone here seen Les Miserables or Phantom of the Opera or Sunset Boulevard or Ragtime? Beauty and the Beast. I bet you've seen Beauty and the Beast. These are all shows that I worked on and I was proud of it and I loved it and that was my life. But, you know, I also cared about my country and I cared about news and I cared about politics and I cared about government. And when I learned that this guy, Andrew Breitbart, which literally no one really had heard about, was starting a new website to compete with the Huffington Post, and it was supposed to be like conservatives who work in the entertainment business who aren't the Huffington Post, you know, who aren't liberal, who aren't progressive, and believe it or not, there are many of us. I reached out to him and I said, listen, I know this is LA-based, it's very TV and Hollywood and films, but I work in theater. And if the entertainment business leans to the left, Broadway leans so far to the left they've fallen and they can't get up. It's beyond liberals, beyond progressive. But in a weird way, this actually set me up for what I do now, because I was able to be who I was and have conversations with people that I worked with and loved and cared about and were friends with in my industry who vehemently disagreed with everything that I believed in politics, and I vehemently disagreed with them, but we were still friends. And that's a key skill to have, I think, no matter what you decide to do with the rest of your life. And so now I can do talk radio, or I can do a speech, or I can do a television appearance. You may have seen me on Tucker Carlson. I'm one of the few people that Tucker doesn't look at like this. And y'all do it yourself, don't you, Mary? You want to do that? Yeah. And so I've been able to do that, and I've been able to have those conversations, even with people who disagree with me, because you know, anyone here from the Washington area? Hardly the reddest area in the country, hardly, you know, Oklahoma, as it were. It's kind of liberal. You don't grow a radio audience here in D.C., and thank God I've been able to do that. Our whole station has been able to do that by alienating people who disagree with you, by actually suggesting to the people who disagree with you that they have a mental disorder, that they are ignorant, that they are stupid, that they are mind-numbed zombies. I mean, they could very well be all those things, but you don't start the conversation with them like that, and you actually are able to put forth your ideas and invite them to come in and tell you why you're wrong, right? I lay this out for you because that's what's missing from our press right now, right? When was the last time you saw that on broadcast news? When was the last time you saw that on cable news? It's become so bifurcated, it's become so ghettoized that there's this channel for these people and those channel for those people, and what's worse, that channel for those people, they don't want me to watch. When I tune in and see one of the channels that clearly is not appealing to me, the last thing they want is for me to be a part of the conversation. That's a problem. It's a problem for our country, and that brings me to these midterms and the problem for the press, because they didn't learn the most valuable lessons of 2016. In 2016, the media in this country, for the most part, looked like fools. I mean, who here, when you're having a bad night, searches out on YouTube the election night videos, the montage? Is brilliant, right? They're the best. I do. My wife, sometimes if I've had a bad day and we're sitting in bed and, you know, she's checking her laptop and she'll hear, you know, next to her, you know, Rachel Maddow weeping in tears and Chris Matthews saying, how can this be happening? And she's like, honey, please give it a rest. And I'm like, no, I need this. I just need this right now. And we need that sometimes. But, and it was great, and it's wonderful to watch, but if you're in this profession, you'd think by the end of that night, maybe the next day, you'd have a post-mortem. You'd have a re-evaluation of what you're doing and say, hey, you know, we kind of got it wrong here. Let's not make that mistake again. Well, for the last year, maybe two, we've been told there was going to be a blue wave this week, right? That it was going to be an undeniable, complete repudiation of everything Trump, everything Republican, everything conservative, everything not Democrat. Who, by the way, I prepared these remarks before I knew everything that was going on in Florida over the last 24 hours. So, I mean, I guess there could be a blue wave, but I didn't realize it was going to be a blue crime wave. But assuming we do end up gaining some seats in the Senate, and assuming that the Democrats in the House end up gaining, let's say, 35 seats, what ended up happening this week was pretty much your average typical midterm after a president's first 2 years. It wasn't nearly as bad as what happened to Barack Obama. It wasn't nearly as bad as what happened to Bill Clinton. It was a little bit worse than what happened to Ronald Reagan. But think about it for a minute. The day after the election 2 years ago, when Donald Trump won, basically what happened this week was baked in the cake, right? This was your typical average response. But after 2 years of media coverage of this president and this party, and you, the voters, assuming that you voted for Donald Trump, they couldn't move the needle any more than your average midterm election. My friends at Media Research Center, which is a great organization if you get a chance to look at them and work with them, they've done analysis of the coverage of this president, and they've averaged around 90% to 92% negative coverage of the president. And understand, when they're covering this president negatively, they're covering the party negatively, and they're covering the voters negatively. That's part of the story from the media. So imagine that, 90% negative coverage. And when I say negative, I mean, let's just be clear here. It's not, I have some issues with this tax cut because there may be some problems with the deficit. No, no, no. The negative coverage is, this man is Hitler. This man's a fascist. This man is going to kill children if he hasn't already. I mean, that goes beyond negative coverage. And they still just had their typical standard midterm election. So the media has, and by the way, all of the predictive models, I heard people day before the election on television saying this could be 65 to 70 seats for the Democrats. I mean, what's the point of a political press, the first P of my four Ps, if you're keeping score at home, what's the point of a press if they think their job is to tell you what's going to happen in their opinion? That's not the purpose of a press. The purpose of a press is to tell you what has happened, contextualize it, give you as much information so that you can make up your mind about whether you approve of whether what just happened is what you wanted to happen. But when you're involved in predicting what's going to happen and assuring at an 85% probability that this will happen, you've now become the guys on ESPN who tell you that the Rutgers is going to win today, and they're really not. Sorry. It's the only time I root for blue over red. So the press still has a problem. They still haven't learned their lessons. And sadly, I'm afraid that we've reached the point now where this is what we know the political press to be. I don't think it goes back to the way it should be. I don't think it changes. So that brings me back to the National Journalism Center, because we need good, smart people who understand how to communicate messages, how to find the truth, who really care about the truth, and care about the fact that when you turn on some cable networks, it makes perfect sense what they're talking about to people who live in New York, Washington, D.C., San Francisco, Los Angeles, and Chicago. But when I talk to my in-laws in Oklahoma City, they say that this has, what I'm watching on television right now, purported to be the news, is so completely outside the realm of my reality every single day in Oklahoma that it is irrelevant to me. Well, it can't be news and irrelevant at the same time. And so hopefully you might be inspired by that and you'll investigate NJC, because they are an incredible group doing incredible, incredible work. And all, and I mean all of the young people that I've been able to work with at WMAL and at the various websites that I've worked with over the years, they've all been incredible, incredible young men and women who have gone on to good things. So please bear that in mind as we look at what happened this week in the elections. What happened in the elections is not some static thing that you see on television or read on a website. It's part of your lives now. You're part of this country, and now, because you've come and participated in this event, you're part of the national conversation. So you have to find what part of that conversation you are going to be. All right, so we're done with the press. Now the politics of it. That's kind of easy, I think, right? Who thinks that these elections were bad for the president? Go ahead and... Okay, who thinks these elections were good for the president? Interesting. And how many either isn't sure or aren't sure or don't think that it makes a difference one way or the other? Okay, so you're all right. Because it was kind of good and it was kind of bad, and in a way it doesn't really make a big difference. But the important thing of the politics here with regard to the president and the Republican Party, I think, is that they had a choice here, one of two outcomes. They were either going to continue to be the majority in the House with a very, very narrow, narrow, narrow majority, maybe 5 or 10 seats, or they were going to be in the minority to the Democrats, who are going to have a narrow majority. I guess the Democrats are going to end up, they're still counting and recounting and finding ballots, but the Democrats might end up with, like, let's say 15-seat majority, at best a 20-seat majority, all right? That ain't easy. And the Republicans are now positioned in a very interesting way in this town. They have the White House, they have the Senate, but in the House, what have we heard from Republicans in the House for the last couple of years? We can't fund the wall, because then we'll lose re-election. We can't cut spending, because we'll lose re-election. We can't repeal Obamacare, because we'll lose re-election. We can't come down on the deficit and really worry about the national debt, because we're going to lose re-election. So they didn't do any of those things, and they lost re-election. So now they have no excuses, number one, but number two, they're kind of free to go back to what their normal place should be, which is worrying about expanding the size and scope of the federal government, worrying about wasteful spending, actually doing the kind of enforcement of our immigration laws that this president and many Republicans in this town won election on by building the wall. They can actually push those things, and when they say to the president, well, we can't do that because we can't win re-election, the president can say, really? I think you already lost. So now what's your next excuse? And in a strange way, the Democrats are now in a very tough political place, because the seats that they won, many, many, many of them, the ones that they flipped, they were Republican seats for a reason. Those Republicans who were in those seats were elected to do a couple of things. If they were elected in 2010 or 2014, they were elected to do what? Repeal Obamacare. They were elected to cut spending. They were elected to cut taxes. So now when the Democrat comes in there and they want to, what, nationalize Medicare for everybody? That's not what those voters wanted when they put the Republican in the first place. So I know you've got your Alexandria Ocasio-Cortezes. I've been practicing. But she didn't flip a Republican seat, right? She just maintained a Democrat seat in the Bronx. You know, that's going to be a Democrat seat. So that's no problem. The problem for the Democrats are all of those seats that were just now held by Republicans, and whoever's the majority leader or the speaker, it might be Nancy Pelosi, it might not, they're going to have to wrangle them and convince all of those people that they now have to vote with Nancy Pelosi to get things done, because even those Democrats that won in a Republican district this week, they didn't win because those voters wanted Nancy Pelosi to be speaker or wanted the Nancy Pelosi agenda. Right. In fact, if you actually look at the races, the really tough ones, one right down here, Virginia 7, Dave Bratt had been the Republican, or everyone was watching Jennifer Weston, the Democrat, beat Barbara Comstock in Virginia 10, Northern Virginia. Both of those Democrats, heroes and champions of the party right now, neither of them promised to vote for Nancy Pelosi. All right. So this ain't so easy for the Democrats right now. And in a way, the Republicans in the minority, they have an opportunity now to reapply and reestablish what they originally stood for. That's the politics. Now let's get to the bad news. That's power. You know, when I came to Washington, I thought, oh, you know, every city has, you know, an industry, right? New York has Broadway, tourism, finance, fashion. Okay, they've got a lot of industries in New York. LA's got Hollywood, Bay Area, or San Francisco's got homeless. But I guess Silicon Valley, okay, they've got the high tech. Seattle's got Microsoft, right? Every city has sort of a big, and Washington. The big thing in Washington is politics, right? Who here thinks that politics and government is what runs Washington, D.C.? Yes? So this brings us to our third P, power. The industry in Washington, D.C. is power. Now, politics is a means to get that power. That's just how you get it, but when you get it, you use it. And the Democrats, they've got power. They got the chairmanships of all of those committees in the House. Maxine Waters will be the chairwoman of the Financial Services Committee, making banking and finance laws. Elections have consequences. But they also have the power of the subpoena. They have power of investigations. They have power. Our founders built that into the, baked that into the cake. They didn't build cakes, they baked them. I remember, I saw it. And that was baked into the cake. The House of Representatives does, in fact, have a lot of power. It's in the Constitution. However, that power is checked, obviously, by the Senate, by the judiciary, by the executive branch. But most importantly for the House of Representatives, it's checked by us every 2 years, every 2 years. So how they use that power is how they'll be judged 2 years from now. And if it's true that the American people wanted impeachment hearings to begin tomorrow, and that's what they do, they'll be rewarded 2 years from now. But I have a hunch that's not the case, and I have a hunch Nancy Pelosi knows that's not the case. So it'll be very interesting to see how they use that power, but make no mistake, the president and the Republicans need to recognize that that was a big story coming out of this election, that they have attained a serious amount of power, and they will use that power. So it's an interesting time for y'all to watch, because, I mean, really, since you've all started watching American politics in your teenage years, I'm guessing, is when you first started, unless you're a real dork, you've never seen a divided government like this, not at this level, at least. I mean, I guess toward the end of the Obama administration, 2012 to 2014, the House was in Republican hands, the Senate was in Democrat hands, and the presidency was with President Obama. So, but this will be a little more robust, I think, with President Trump. Which brings us to the last P. That would be the presidency. So if this town is all about power, the presidency is the ultimate in power. I remember before I moved to Washington, I was a charming young constitutionally minded libertarian-leaning conservative Republican. And I thought to myself, you know, the presidency is the weakest branch of government. That's what James Madison and Alexander Hamilton had in mind before they were Broadway stars. And it's okay if you don't have the White House, as long as you have the House and the Senate, that's where things really get done. I mean, that's how legislation is born. And the president needs to work with Congress to get those things done. And if he doesn't, the president can't do a thing. I was stupid. Because the presidency is the ultimate power. And everybody wants the presidency. Look at what we've gone through over the last 2 years because the Democrats were so sure that they had the presidency. And they lost it. Yes, a lot of what we've seen over the last 2 years is about Donald Trump, the person, the man, and the policy, but a whole lot of it is about Hillary Clinton and the Democrats knowing that they really, really blew it. And when you don't have the presidency, I think you've seen over the last couple of years, you really can't get a lot done at all. I may not like it, and until we have a Article 5 convention to reevaluate our Constitution and reset things the way those great Broadway founding fathers and the musical hip-hop Hamilton wanted, we're going to have to live with it this way. And that is the presidency is incredibly powerful. And the fact is, after this midterm, I think Donald Trump is in much better position to win the presidency for a couple of reasons. That Senate majority is here. Yeah, okay, sure, yeah, hey, that's exciting. I'm a radio guy, I'm not used to the live audience. I know that they're applauding in their car and then they get into a crash. Couple of reasons, having that majority in the Senate, as long as it doesn't get robbed in Arizona and Florida, is hugely important in terms of confirmations, not just judges, which are incredibly important, but you understand, 300 appointed positions in the administrative branch of government have been waiting for confirmation. Did you know that? This president in 2 years in office now, has 300 people that he's nominated to various positions, ambassadorships, undersecretaries, deputy secretaries, important positions in the state, at the Pentagon, the Defense Department. These are people who are supposed to run our military. And by the way, last time I checked, we're still shooting guns over in Afghanistan and Iraq. People are still getting injured and, God forbid, killed in action. And this Pentagon still can't get key positions filled because the Democrats have been stalling this president's agenda, even to the point of filling key positions that he's wanted filled. Having more senators in there makes it a lot easier to get that done, and that's important, very important, and with trade agreements. Trade agreements don't need the House for approval. Trade agreements and treaties only need the executive branch and the Senate. Same thing. He can get stuff done. We've also seen that he can get stuff done without either of the legislative chambers. Now, we may not have liked it under Barack Obama, but most of the things that the president has tried to get done on the executive side exclusively without the legislative branch have been either undoing what the previous president did. And I'm sorry, you can't tell me that the previous president's executive actions were constitutional, but this president's undoing of those actions is unconstitutional. You can't have it both ways. So undoing what Obama did in the executive branch is important. But secondly, a lot of the things that he's done has been under the guise of national security, which of course as commander-in-chief, the president can do. Having more senators backing him up and having him back his back there is very important. But also, and I think frankly most importantly for the president, if you ask any analyst, they'll tell you that the difference maker in these midterm elections for the Democrats were, I'm sure you've heard it, white, educated, suburban women, right? White, educated, suburban women. I love white, educated, suburban women. I'm married to a white, educated, suburban woman. They're fabulous. They're wonderful. They really are great. And if the Democrats have decided that their future lies in securing and winning more of those votes, God bless them, that's great. But think for a minute. Now, and this is the very important analysis that you have to understand on a midterm election versus a presidential election, right? Midterm elections, 435 separate races, right, in the 435 House districts. For the presidential election, it's 50 races, right? Each state stands alone. So where do these white, suburban, educated women live? Well, they live in the suburbs of major cities. The districts that they won were suburbs of Washington, D.C., New York, California. You see a pattern here? These are states they've already got. Okay, so you won those districts. Yes, they won some districts in others. Oh yeah, suburbs of Chicago. Okay, when was the last time Maryland, Virginia, New York, California, Illinois voted for a Republican? I think the answer is 1984. Maybe 1988. That doesn't help them win the presidency. It may help them win the House, but it doesn't help them win the presidency. And here's the other thing. The messaging that appealed to the white, educated, suburban women in those liberal enclaves of the suburbs around those highly populous metropolitan cities, that's not the same message that wins voters in the Rust Belt. The blue-collar voters, the Ohio voters, the Pennsylvania voters, the Wisconsin voters, the Michigan voters, the voters that they ignored last time, it's almost like they've decided to ignore them this time and next time because their focus now is the white, educated, suburban women. Who here thinks that white, educated, suburban women weren't inclined to vote for Hillary Clinton last time around? I mean, are they going to have a better candidate in 2020 to appeal to white, educated, suburban women than they had last time? Elizabeth Warren? Okay. Kamala Harris, Cory Booker? I mean, honestly, when you look into the future and look at the people who are seriously talked about for their nomination, I think Joe Biden's the only one that really does appeal across the board. And, well, I said seriously, because I don't think he's a serious candidate. I mean, I might be. Let's see it. I'd love to see that debate, Trump versus Biden. But for the presidency, I think this was a pretty good day, actually, when you look at the broader picture. Those are my four P's. Now, before we get to questions, I have two quick stories to tell you that are specifically geared to that whole change the world thing, right? So here are my two stories. I feel bad. Whenever I say I'm going to tell a story, I feel like everybody starts to, like, you know, put their head down on the table. And, you know, it's not like that. These are good stories, I promise. I mentioned Andrew Breitbart. Do you know who this guy is? I know you know the website, but do you know the man, Andrew Breitbart? Yes? Let's hear it if you do. Okay. So Andrew Breitbart, the man who started Breitbart News, passed away March 1st, 2012. We launched Breitbart News Network March 5th, 2012, 4 days after his death, but we were in the process of doing it. Before we combined the sites that you now know as Breitbart News Network, he had five different sites. He had Breitbart News, which aggregated news and was often linked to on the Drudge Report. That's how I first got the name. It's like, who's this Breitbart guy? It's like, got a Drudge link. Well, then I found out he was the editor of the Drudge Report. He was Matt Drudge's partner in the early days of the Drudge Report during the Monica Lewinsky scandal. He had Breitbart News, he had big government, he had big Hollywood, he had big journalism, he had big peace, he liked big. It was a big part of the plan. I started working for him at Big Hollywood. That's where I started writing for him, and then I ended up running a thing called Breitbart TV, which was aggregating conservative videos, or videos that would appeal to a conservative audience. That was cutting edge back in 2009, 2010. Now you see a lot of sites like that. Things happen fast. Andrew Breitbart spoke to a group just like this. It was in Berkeley, UC Berkeley, the Young Republicans on the Berkeley campus. Yes, there really is one. Anyone here from Berkeley? Hey! That guy. It's like, so they didn't beat you up or anything when Shapiro or Milo came? Or, all right, good. He came and spoke to that group, and I think it may have even been sponsored by Young America's Foundation. He went up from LA, he was an LA guy, and he delivered a message to that group. It was the same message that I heard him deliver over and over and over again. This was 2008 when he delivered this message. I didn't know him yet, but I've heard the story many times. He said to these young Republicans just like you, do you want to change the world? And they all did what you did. You want to change the world? Yeah! Don't go to Washington, D.C. Now, I know that seems weird, because you think, if we're going to change the world and we're Americans, we got to go to our capital city, but that's where we got to go. Okay, well, that's true to a certain extent. But what I've learned about Washington, D.C. and what Andrew Breitbart knew 10 years ago was that this town reacts to what happens out there. This town doesn't actually drive anything. Think about gay marriage, same-sex marriage, right? I don't care what your opinion is on it. Do you think that same-sex marriage was legalized because the Supreme Court on a 5-4 decision said it was going to be legalized? I mean, yes, technically that's what happened. But what happened was Will and Grace was a popular top 10 sitcom. What happened was Mr. Smithers was obviously gay on The Simpsons, and you know, we accepted that. What happened was our pop culture had introduced the idea that there was nothing wrong with these relationships well before our government took up the issue. What happened was people's minds were changed through Hollywood, through television, through film, through music. What happened was politicians figured out after the fact that something had started without them having a say in it at all. What Andrew Breitbart would say was, if you really want to change the world, we need more voices in the arts. We need more voices in pop culture. When I speak to your parents, and I often do, I often say, how many people here are sick of liberal Hollywood? And they all are. And I said, okay, now how many have encouraged your kids to be actors and writers and directors? Exactly. Daddy, Daddy, I want to be an actor. No kid of mine is going to be an actor. You're going to be a lawyer. Okay. Because lawyers are really good for our country, and they're not liberal, and that's what happened. So Andrew Breitbart is telling that story, and there was a young man in that room who came up to him afterwards and said, Andrew, I hear you, and you've converted me. I wanted to go to DC, but now I don't. I want to come work for you. Hire me. And Andrew hadn't hired anybody. But he was so taken by this kid. He said, well, where are you from? He said, I'm from LA. He was so taken by him that he did hire him. And I know it seems corny that I'm about to say, and that young man was me, but it wasn't. It's actually much better than that. That young man was the first person Andrew Breitbart ever hired. In his first day on the job, when Andrew was still working out of his house, he had to move a bed in Andrew's home from a downstairs basement room to an upstairs bedroom because he was converting his basement to an office. Glorious first day on the job, right? He was the first person hired by Andrew Breitbart, and he still works for Andrew Breitbart. His title now is editor-in-chief of Breitbart News Network. His name is Alex Marlowe. And if you listen to the Breitbart News Radio on Sirius XM, he's usually the host of that show. And he's a great guy. And ironically, he did end up eventually moving to DC, but not for power, not to influence, not for the work. He moved because his wife got a job at George Washington Hospital. So you can change the world. Who here would say that legitimately Alex Marlowe's work and Breitbart News Network and the whole new media revolution that Breitbart was a part of and Andrew Breitbart the man was a leading force of 10 years ago? How many would acknowledge that they were a big part of changing the media narrative in the last 4 years in this country and frankly a part of getting Donald Trump elected? I would absolutely say that. Is that changing the world? All right. So, the answer to change the world isn't always here in DC. And one last thing that might seem a little more, because now you're thinking, oh God, okay, so I gotta be the editor-in-chief of Breitbart? Shit, I don't know why I'm gonna do that. All right, one other story that might seem a little more realistic. In these midterms, there was a story here, a couple of you are from Northern Virginia, right? You saw me beforehand, right? Okay. So you might know this story, but you probably don't because it didn't get a whole lot of coverage. Everyone's talking about the House, everyone's talking about the Senate, everyone's talking about the crimes in Florida, everyone's talking about that stuff. Prince William County, Virginia, this last Tuesday, had an election for the chair of their school board. Have you heard this? I'm shocked. I'm kidding. Of course you didn't hear about it. It's the school board of Prince William County. Well, here's what happened. It was a vacant seat. There was a Democrat in the seat. He resigned. It's a long story. I won't even get into it. But it was very hotly contested, this school board seat. And what happened was it was neck and neck in the polls. 2 weeks before the election, a political action committee was formed. All right? And the name of the political action committee was Republicans for Stanley Bender. And Republicans for Stanley Bender got some money, like any political action committee would, and their whole job was to print up signs that say, red signs, by the way, red signs, very important, that say Republicans for Stanley Bender. And they put those signs out in front of every polling place in Prince William County in Northern Virginia. Now in Virginia, for the school board, there is no party nomenclature on the ballot. Okay, it doesn't say here's the Democrat, here's the Republican. However, the parties do endorse a candidate, okay? In Prince William County, the Republicans did not endorse Stanley Bender, but the signs all said Republicans for Stanley Bender. Stanley Bender was not endorsed by the Republicans or the Democrats. Stanley Bender was an independent. Stanley Bender ended up getting about 7 to 8% of the vote. He didn't win, but it was enough to give the Democrat the victory with 47% of the vote. Now, I think you know where I'm going with this. Republicans for Stanley Bender was formed by the former chairman of the Prince William County Democratic Party. A Democrat formed this committee to trick voters into voting for that guy, thinking they were voting for the Republican-endorsed candidate, and it got the Democrat the victory. Now, I don't tell you this story to say those Democrats will cheat and they'll lie and they're terrible and they're awful because, well, you know, that's like a dog bites man story, of course. We know that. But we don't know that they broke the law. In fact, I don't think they did break the law. There's a question as to whether they broke one of the laws because you're supposed to get the candidate's permission to use their name and signs. But really, when all is said and done, this guy's going to get a fine. But the key is the Democrat is going to be the chair of the school board in Prince William County. The reason I tell you this story is this. If the Democrats are willing to cheat and lie and go to this effort to print up these signs, to fool voters into getting their guy elected to the Prince William County School Board, doesn't that tell you how important the school board is? Doesn't it tell you that they understand the power and influence and importance that school board members have on the public schools that we're all paying for? So if you really want to change the world, and I know you do, you might not be a senator, and you might not be the president, and you might not be a congressman, but you might be a school board member. Whatever other job you might have, whatever other profession you choose, you could also be on the school board, and you can make a difference. And I don't know, to me, getting a job in DC for a big lobbying firm or as a staffer for a congressman or the third junior gopher page for the secretary of who knows what, that may be cool for a while. But having an influence on the education and cultural upbringing of America's children, that's the kind of changing of the world that I want to put my hat on. So wherever you go in life, always know that politics, culture, the important things that make our country thrive are happening in your neighborhoods, wherever you are, and you can make that difference if you're willing to put in the effort. Because ultimately, we spend so much time and so much money and so much focus on who sits in that Oval Office right down the street from here every 4 years that we forget about all those other elections. And ultimately, what happens in your house is, in fact, much more important than what happens in the White House. Now I'll open it up to questions, if you can. Thank you. And we're taking questions, oh, wait, which one? They just switched the cameras, oh, hi. But we're taking questions online as well.
This one comes from our virtual pass attendee. This is Anna from Philadelphia. She asks, as somebody in the media, do you feel the president made the right choice in revoking Jim Acosta's press pass?
Okay. So first of all, do we know it was the president's single decision? I mean, I hope they didn't walk into the president's office and say, hey, we want to revoke Acosta's press pass. You okay with that? And I hope the president didn't storm down the hall and say, you revoke Acosta's press pass. But whosever decision it was, yes, I do think it was the right decision. Thanks for the question in Philadelphia. For a couple of reasons. Most importantly, is we got to send the message that this is just inappropriate and unacceptable behavior, right? And I don't care if you think that it was, you know, a karate chop to this young woman's arm or if you think he was just nudging him. I had not seen a slow motion replay. This happened about an hour before I came on the air, and in describing it to my audience on the radio, I said, Jim Acosta suddenly looked like a power forward fighting for a rebound under the basket, and, you know, that's what he did. And, you know, maybe it's because I'm a little older and I have teenage daughters, but that's somebody's daughter. That could have been my daughter. And I'd be pretty ticked off about that. And this is the East Room of the White House. That's one reason. But the second reason is this growing problem in these White House press briefings. See, to me, he's the senior White House correspondent for CNN, right? So to me, the job of a senior White House correspondent is to do, or any kind of White House correspondent, is to do two things. Number one, you attend the press briefings and you ask questions that go beyond the official statement of the White House so you can maybe elicit more information for the American people, elicit more information for your viewers or for your readers. Don't just print what the White House tells you to print, because then why do we need a press corps? And, you know, we're sick of the 8 years under Obama when that happened. No, ask some questions, get some more information, give them more details. That's the first job. But it's not to debate and argue with the person up there. You know, save that for the studio. And the second job of a White House correspondent is to build up your relationships, build up your access, try to get some exclusives, get some scoops. That's all good for business, good for us, the American public. From my perspective, Jim Acosta is doing neither. I don't think he's a White House correspondent anymore. He's an on-site debater. He's an one could call him a master debater. I'm still a teenage boy at heart. And the question at hand here that started this whole brouhaha, he stood up and his exact words, I've memorized them, was, thank you, Mr. President. I want to challenge you on something you said during the campaign. Okay, let's have a drink across the street at Old Ubbets Grill and you can challenge me. But right now your job is to be a reporter and you're not here to challenge me, you're here to ask me a question. So to me, he wasn't fulfilling the function anymore, so I think the president was justified in that move. And actually, frankly, the ball is now in CNN's court. CNN needs to send a message, not just to the other people who work at CNN, but to all reporters everywhere. Is this what CNN wants from their reporters? Every young reporter coming up, are they to look at this and say, oh, this is the pathway to success. This is what my industry rewards. CNN needs to do something about this. And I'm not saying fire Jim Acosta. Unlike the left, unlike media analysts, ironically, who work at CNN, I don't think anyone needs to be fired. I think Jim Acosta has sort of played out his usefulness there at the White House. I think he should get a great studio job. Replace Wolf Blitzer. Wolf Blitzer is ridiculous. Have him get in the studio. He can do a great job there. Next question. Oh, there's like this long walk to the, it's great. It's like a runway. It's like, okay.
Hi,
who are you wearing?
Calvin Klein, actually.
Hey.
Thank you for coming to speak to us today. My name is Sarah Long. I'm the chairman at the University of Florida chapter of Young Americans for Freedom.
Ooh, did they beat South Carolina? They were behind by a touchdown.
I think we were up last time.
They won? They came
there
from behind
go.
And beat South. Oh, there you go. Hey. Look at all the Gators.
So my question.
So if you're watching online, half of the crowd just did this. There's a whole lot of Florida Gators.
Yeah.
Sorry about that, Sarah.
My
go
question
ahead.
For you today is if you've been following the Florida election just with the Senate and the governorship,
yeah.
The more I read about it, the angrier I get. So, for example, they just mixed in 15 rejected provisional ballots that all got counted with 208 other ballots.
It's unbelievable.
And our lieutenant governor just reported, or our former lieutenant governor just tweeted out that there was an affidavit signed of an election official witnessing blank ballots being filled out after following the election in
yeah.
Brevard County. So my question for you is, do you attribute this all of this kind of stuff to just malice, or do you think that there may be just incompetence in Florida happening?
Yeah,
right
that's
now?
A great question, because I see a lot of people saying, well, I don't know if it's criminal, but it's incompetent. Well, how about this? It's criminally incompetent. Okay? Because there are laws on the books. There are laws set up for these elections for the sole purpose that we don't have to go through this, that the American people don't think that it's being robbed, that there's transparency laws. They're supposed to say how many ballots are still outstanding that need to be counted. All of the early, notice, were you watching the midterm election results? And as soon as the polls closed, they had these results, right? Those were the early ballots, because every state counts the ballots early because, well, they're early, and they've got them, and they upload them into the system. And in Florida, the law is that you have to upload all of those ballots the night before the election by 7:30 p.m., and a half an hour after the polls close, you have to report the results. Broward County still hasn't done, what day is today, Saturday? They still haven't done that. So they are breaking the law. Just by definition, this is an unlawful process, and therefore unlawful to me, look it up, thesaurus, criminal. It's criminally incompetent. Marco Rubio's Twitter feed is fantastic on this. I actually praised him. I actually tweeted right before I got up here. I said, I like this Marco Rubio. He should come around more often. And somebody reminded me on Twitter, well, you know, it's really, he's concerned because he's next. And that's true. His election is coming up 4 years from now. So it's a big mess. And I hope, it's shocking. I actually spoke with a Republican who was part of the first Florida recount, which, you know, you were 1 year old, I think, when that happened, right? There was a Republican who was down there and part of that process and now working here in Washington, and I won't name this person, but I saw him the other day. And I said, so do they know what they're doing? Are they lawyered up? Are they good? And I said, well, I called them and I asked if they did. And then I asked them this, this, and this, and they had no idea. So I'm concerned that the Republicans are not lawyered up the right way. I'm concerned that they're not, you know, going about this process in a way that they want to win, because the Democrats are. And, you know, you're witnessing, in my opinion, the attempted theft of an election. So we'll see. Good luck down there.
Thank you.
You bet. Thank you. Are you all going to steal that blue wave, criminal wave thing, the crime wave? Blue wave, crime wave, it's good. Yes, sir.
I also
what college football team do you represent?
The Florida Gators.
Oh, God.
I also want to thank you for coming out today. I enjoy your style a lot. You remind me of a taller Greg Gutfeld. So.
He's really more of a shorter Larry O'Connor, but I'll take it. Thank you.
Okay.
I'm kidding.
My name is Matt. I'm also from the UFEF chapter. And so I've noted, especially since the Donald Trump election, that the division of the right and left has gotten progressively worse and worse, seemingly by the day. Where do you project, outside of his approval ratings going up since he was elected,
yeah.
which is good, where do you project the rift between the two parties headed in coming years? Because it just seems like it's going to boil over at one point.
Yeah, I change my mind about this on a daily basis, which, by the way, is okay for you to do. You know, if any time, hey, 3 weeks ago you said this and now you're saying this. Yeah, because people learn and grow and get more information. Sometimes I think it's horrible and it's never going to get better and it's never been worse. But then I remember, you know, here's the thing. We've been a divided country for a while. I mean, I'm old enough to remember when both Bushes were president and they were both Hitler, okay? It's true. I mean, they called Ronald Reagan a racist. They called him a xenophobic. They called him, back then we weren't Islamophobic, we were anti-communist, right? Which, believe it or not, was a bad thing to some people in this country. So they said all of those things about Reagan. They've said those things about conservatives from forever. I think the difference, what we're witnessing here, is the hyper-focus every minute of our day in every possible outlet, on our Facebook, on our Instagram, on our Twitter feed, on our late-night comedy shows that are supposed to be about comedy and escape. In the sports world, everywhere, it's the conversation, and that, I think, is the problem, and that, I think, is easier to change, hopefully. I think, hopefully, people will start saying, you know what? Our country shouldn't revolve around Washington, D.C. politics every day and every night. There are bigger things in our world, and there are bigger things in our lives. And hopefully, you know, competition is a beautiful thing. I hope one of the networks actually does a late-night comedy show that never mentions politics. And I bet you it'll be hugely successful. So I think we've always been divided. I think the difference is we've got hyper-focus on it right now. Thanks for the question. I hope that answered it.
Thank you very much.
All right. Anyone from a Big Ten school? Maybe Big 12?
Well, my college actually doesn't even have a football team.
So, oh,
yeah.
Next.
A little disappointing.
Hillsdale?
George Washington University.
Oh, George Washington.
Yeah.
Oh,
mm-hmm.
Well,
yeah. Yep, so my name's Karen from GW.
I'm the Redskins.
Yeah. I'm actually a National Journalism Center alum.
Yay!
So my question
I didn't repeat anything from the last speech I gave to you guys, did I?
Maybe a little.
Well, no, I do that what happens in your house is more important than what happens in the White House in every speech. Mm-hmm. So, okay, all right.
You're good. So I guess my question is from the perspective of a journalist. Trump has obviously called, like, the media the enemy of the people.
No, he's not. He's calling fake news media the enemy. Just don't be fake and you won't be the enemy. It's fine.
So do you think that kind of like this bridge the divide between the media and this administration will kind of be long withstanding past when Trump leaves office? Do you think that's going to have kind of like repercussions for future presidential administrations? And if so, how can journalists kind of like bridge that divide?
Okay. Well, the media has always been hostile to Republicans. I hate to keep saying this, but does anyone think that if Ted Cruz had been president, the media would have said, yay, Ted? You know, they were going to be, John Kasich won, if Jeb Bush won. I mean, they were very hostile to George W. Bush. Go back and check YouTube out. Go to Media Research Center. They have an incredible archive of this stuff, and you'll see how the press treated every Republican president. It's very hostile. It's very ugly. Now, is this the ugliest we've ever seen? Of course. What's the difference? Trump actually fights back. Trump actually says, bullshit. Yeah, sorry. I'm quoting the president. Something great happened. You know, this president has given the media more access, journalists more access than his both predecessors combined, I would calculate. Certainly his the last president. And reporters, honest reporters, will admit that. He can't wait. How many times did you see Barack Obama when he was walking toward Marine One where he went, and answer any question. Hey, good to see you. I'm sorry, it's too loud. Trump makes a beeline for the reporters. He did it yesterday. And somebody, I played this bite like all 3 hours on my show yesterday where the reporter asked him a question and his response was, what a stupid question. What a stupid, and I watch you. You ask a lot of stupid questions. And that was a so the difference here is that George W. Bush and Herbert Walker Bush and God knows Ronald Reagan, in their minds, they were thinking, what a stupid question. But they didn't say it. Trump says it, and that magnifies it that much more because the media is not used to him fighting back. And so then they fight back even more, and it's gotten ugly. I do think that that aspect of it ends with Trump. I think that the hyper 24/7, every show, every minute of every show covering President Trump ends with President Trump, I think. Unless the person who replaces him is another celebrity, bigger than life kind of figure. But I think that's what ends it. But make no mistake and don't kid yourself, the animosity between the media, journalists, especially DC journalists, and a Republican conservative administration did not begin 2 years ago when Trump won the White House. It's, for as long as I've been watching this, and that's since the Reagan era, this is what it's been like.
Thank you.
You bet. Are you applauding that the media hates Republicans? 'Cause that's...
So our last question comes from a virtual attendee. Lauren in Los Angeles, California.
Hey, Lauren, LA! Woo!
What is the most valuable piece of advice for young people who have little experience but are trying to break into major media markets such as Los Angeles?
Oh, wow. Well, okay, so I used to live in LA when I started my media job and or my media career, and I moved out of Los Angeles. So there it is. I'll say this. Well, if I could, stop thinking in terms of media markets. Okay, this is an incredible, incredible time that you're all living in. And I listen, it depends on the job that you want. If you really want to be, you know, that person who goes and stands on the corner of 7th and Figueroa and reports about a bus crash and how a turnip truck got flipped over and it's causing havoc in the traffic, you can only do that locally in a certain market. 7th and Figueroa is an LA thing, whatever city you're in. But if you want a job in the media, do y'all see the movie Chaplin? Do you ever see that movie Chaplin? It's a great movie. It's about Charlie Chaplin, Robert Downey Jr. before he was Iron Man, and before he was in rehab, by the way. He plays Chaplin. And there's this amazing scene in Chaplin where he's just been hired by Max Sennett, who did the old black and white films, the Keystone Cop movies. And Charlie Chaplin was his first huge, giant star other than Mabel Normand. I'm talking about silent movies now, forget it. The point is, Charlie Chaplin was hired from the music halls in London to come and do silent movies. And he gets off the train, and he steps off the train, and he's got his little suitcases, and he looks, and there's this shot of rolling hills, and it's all agriculture, it's all crops, it's all orange trees and orange groves. And the little title underneath says, San Fernando Valley, California, 1919, whatever year it was. Now, if anybody knows the San Fernando Valley of California, it's now the most populous region pretty much in this country, except for New York City. It's nothing but sprawling industry and houses and Burbank and the films and Disney and the networks and everything. And that all happened, and we all know that that happened, pretty much by 1965. So in 50 years, those sprawling landscapes of agriculture turned into what we now know as the entertainment capital of the world. And I tell you this because I feel like that's where we are right now in the media landscape on this planet. With the internet, with streaming video, with the fact that we all have a movie, forget about a movie studio, we have a live video production house in our pockets, every single one of us, that has the capability of communicating with literally everyone in this country and everyone in the free world. We haven't begun to tap the powerful potential of what each of us as individuals can do without the gatekeepers that used to be there for media in this country, without the networks, without the studios telling you, okay, fine, you can do it. I mean, how many of you watch YouTube stars right now that have never been on television before, that have never had it? You all do, because you're all the same age as my kids, and they'll be watching someone on YouTube that's getting millions of hits. Like, who the hell is that? Oh, he's huge. No, he's not. He's not on Channel 4. Well, you don't need Channel 4 anymore. Think of the media landscape in our country, in this world right now, on this planet, like those orange groves. 50 years from now, it's going to be populated. Right now, you guys are on this frontier, on the edge of it, and it is for you to grab and take. So, long way to answer the question, but that's what I did. I wanted to be a radio host. After 20 years of working in the Broadway theater as a manager and a finance supervisor guy, I wanted to be a radio host. And how do you do that? Well, there was a thing called internet radio. It was very new. It was like at the dawn of podcasting, but unlike podcasting, where you just record something and save it and then people download it, it was live. I plugged in a microphone to my computer, I hit a button, and I pushed it out on my social media, and suddenly I had an audience. And I did it every single night, and I just started a show. And by the end of a year, I was filling in for Dennis Miller on his radio show. Literally anyone can do that, because you have all the tools, you have all the technology. It's incredible the opportunities that you have. So don't limit yourself. Don't think within the confines of a market, because the entire world literally is your market right now. What you need to do is commit yourself to doing it every single day, and every single day you'll get better than you were the day before, and eventually someone will notice and actually start paying you for it. All right, that's my answer to that.